Today's episode of This Week in Startups is brought to you by Citrix ShareFile, secure file transfer, built for business. Visit ShareFile.com. Click on the microphone and enter Twist for a free 30-day trial. And by Citrix GoToMeeting, meeting is believing. Sign up for a free 30-day trial by using the promo code Twist. Visit GoToMeeting.com today. And by AWS Activate, the Amazon Web Services startup program. It's easy to start and scale your business with AWS. Visit aws.amazon.com/activate.
Hey everybody, it's Jason Calacanis. I'm here in Southern California with the beautiful Pacific Coast behind me at the Recode Conference, which is a conference thrown in the technology industry by Walt Mossberg and Kara Swisher. It's a wonderful conference where 600 leaders in the world come together to talk about technology. And today on the program, Eric Hippeau, the legendary publisher and investor in companies like BuzzFeed, Circa, and of course, Huffington Post. He's a legend in publishing, and we do a really interesting deep dive into what's happening in content today and what's happened in the past, including the New York Times and BuzzFeed and Huffington Post and Gawker and native advertising. It's just, if you're into publishing and technology, you're going to love this episode. Please enjoy, and thanks again to my friends, Walt and Kara, for hosting me here at the Recode Conference.
That's what it's all about, man. They said, money is the root of all evil. What? Funny how it feeds my people. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money, and defeat you. Money is the root of all evil. What? Funny how it feeds my people. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money, and defeat you.
Hey everybody, welcome back. It's Jason Calacanis. This is This Week in Startups, the show where we talk about technology, venture capitalists, angel investing, all those great things. And we have a legend in the business. Eric Hippeau is with us today. He has done venture capital for over 20 years, media companies for over 20 years, and technology for 20 years. You've done basically it all. When we met in the 90s, I was doing a magazine and you were running a magazine company called Ziff Davis.
That's right. Yeah.
How did you wind up getting into the media business? I never knew how you got in there, but you were, when I, just so you know, when I was coming up as a young 20-year-old, you were running Ziff Davis, which was like the dream of like all publishers, like PC Magazine and everything. How did you get started in all
that? Well, we were the gold standard. We can come
back. The gold
back
standard.
And, we can come back and talk. I escaped college. I was going to. I was educated in London, but I was brought up in the French school system. So the natural university to go to was the Sorbonne.
Right.
And I was really bored at the Sorbonne. And I was bored of being in France, and I was bored by the Sorbonne. And so I took a job during the day as a photojournalist.
Is going to the Sorbonne like going to Harvard?
No.
What is it like?
Harvard
what
is actually,
because I hear Sorbonne all the time. I've never been there. What does it mean?
Yeah, it's highfalutin stuff. It's
like
it's,
what, going to Cornell or something? Oxford?
Maybe Oxford. I don't know. Yeah. It's all this kind of like, you know, theories that the French have about life, and as we know, that doesn't really work well for them. But they have all these theories. And,
gotcha.
So anyway, so you get
indoctrinated.
You get indoctrinated, and all the professors are Marxists and communists and all that.
And what? That didn't vibe with you?
I don't mind Marxists and communists, but it doesn't really help, you know, me progress in life that much.
Yeah. So. Didn't speak to you, the communism and the Marxism.
No. The idea that, what is mine and what is yours is mine, it doesn't really resonate well with me. So
you get a job.
So I got a job as a photojournalist, and I went to school at night, mostly to pick up girls. It was actually good for that. And,
what is this, the 80s?
No. We're talking about the late 60s, early 70s.
God, you look so young, Eric. Okay, this is like the early 70s, and you get a job as a photojournalist.
Yeah, my father was an executive at UPI, and I've always been interested in journalism.
Right.
And actually, I'm a fifth generation journalist, so there's five generations before me who were all
You're
journalists.
You're kidding.
Yeah. And so it was kind of the company, the family business. So anyway, I take this job. And then my parents moved to Brazil. My father becomes country manager in Brazil for UPI. And I stayed at the Sorbonne a little while longer. And I said, what's the point of doing that? So I bought a one-way ticket to go to Brazil. I knew nothing about Brazil, did not speak Portuguese or anything like this. And I landed in Rio, no intention of coming back, not knowing whether I was going to stay in Brazil or not. And so I take a job. Because my father was a legal resident, I have a work permit. This is during the military dictatorship.
Wow.
In 1971, So 1970. And so it's very hard to get a work permit. But I have a work permit. So I take a job as the sports editor at the local English language newspaper, which was published daily for expats, you know, throughout. It was actually a pretty big paper. It was 45,000.
All of South America?
No, it was all Brazil.
All Brazil.
It was called the Brazil Herald. And I knew nothing about American sports, but, you know, it's, you know.
How hard could it be?
How hard could it be? To this day, I don't know the rules in baseball, but, you know, you kind of, you make it up, you know. So, long story short, one day I'm there minding my own business, and the entire newsroom, the editor-in-chief and the entire newsroom has a fight with the publisher, and they all leave.
Wow.
And the publisher says to me, well, you're the only one left. This newspaper has been published every day now for 40-plus years, so you and I are going to publish the newspaper.
Oh, my God.
Edit the newspaper. So we worked all night, and we edited the newspaper. And the next day, he made me the editor-in-chief. He was nobody else.
Wow.
So by default, I became the editor-in-chief, and I was like 20 years old.
So he selected from all the great candidates who should be in charge, and that was you.
Well, there was nobody speaking
English
there.
Exactly. So. One of one. Congratulations.
So I ended up editor-in-chief of this daily newspaper. So it was better than a college education. Right?
Yeah, of course.
In a country under military dictatorship where I'm subject to censorship, and there is such thing as a secret police, and if you don't...
you could disappear.
You could literally disappear.
And tortured.
Actually,
murdered.
My biggest problem wasn't that, because I made peace with those guys, and our audience really cared more about the news from the U.S. And, and England, you know. But my biggest problem was that it was hard for me to recruit people to work there because they had to have a work permit. So I used to get infiltrated all the time by Amnesty International, and if I didn't pay, if I took a day off, or if I, you know, went early, home early or something, these people would plant a story while I wasn't looking.
Wow.
In defiance of the censors. So I you know, my job was to be there all the time. I basically lived there.
And make sure that you didn't have to take credit for an Amnesty story about human rights and then disappear yourself.
And then once in a while, the secret police would walk into my newsroom and pick up a couple people who they knew were from Amnesty International. And they wouldn't do anything bad to them. You know, actually, Brazil's military dictatorship wasn't like the Argentinians, where you know, they would pick people up and then they would drop them alive from airplanes. You know, the Brazilians didn't do anything like that. So anyway, they would deport them.
Yeah.
So anyway, so I did that, and then we started a kind of a computer. We called it computers and automation. So it was at the time where mini computers were starting to be sold, and were really changing the whole world. And
like in the 70s, the Vaxes and stuff
like
without,
that. The Dex and Data General and Vax. Yeah, those machines. Well,
that's when I was 8 years old in 78, I got to get on those for the first time.
So I started this section that was a weekly section called Computer Automation that was about, you know, innovation in that with minis.
Before Apple Computer had ever been founded.
Oh, way before.
Before Microsoft had ever been.
Way before. And that section was actually quite popular because our audience were mostly business people and rich business people from, you know, big companies, right?
Right.
And they had nothing else. They had no other information. So I said to the publisher, let's, you know, this is so popular. It doesn't really belong in the daily newspaper. Why don't we just spin it off and we'll create Brazil's first computer magazine?
Wow.
And he wasn't interested. So I said, well, you know, this seems like a big opportunity to me. So if I can find financing, will you, you know, can I keep the name or whatever it was, the assets? So I did find, I found some financing. And so I started kind of a bi-weekly, every other week, newspaper / magazine called Data News. But it was all in Portuguese. And it was Brazil's first computer magazine, literally. And then, so I published this for a few months, and then the military guys decided that computing was a matter of national security, and that all computers had to be manufactured in Brazil. Believe that. I mean, it's unbelievable the stuff that these people would do. So from literally from one moment to another, from one day to another, I lost all my advertisers because you couldn't import computers anymore.
Wow.
A gentleman by the name of Pat McGovern, who just passed away.
Just passed away from IDG.
From IDG, just passed away, had written me a letter
A letter.
There was no
email. No email.
A letter from the U.S. to Brazil could take 2 months to get there, right?
Right. So he writes a letter from Boston.
I had sent him, I don't know why, I had sent him a copy of Data News.
Yeah.
And he, even though he couldn't read it, he sent me a letter saying, oh my God, you know, welcome, you know, to the world of computer publishing. We're pioneers. If I ever can be of assistance, let me know.
This is a different Pat McGovern than a lot of other people experienced later in life. He was a dogged competitor.
Oh yeah, yeah, he was. But he. I guess this is
the 70s when it was like there were only three or four publications. Period.
Yeah. Plus, I don't think he had any intentions, at least at that time, to be in Latin America.
That's incredible. Right?
Yeah, so,
and even then, he had international aspirations or awareness, Pat McGovern.
Yeah, but he was in Europe already. He was in Europe. I think he already had computer worlds in Germany and the UK and whatnot. So anyway, I find him,
right?
And I said, listen, this is what's happening. I think there's a big future, but right now it's not looking good because we can't import computers. But would you be interested in establishing Computer World? And I'll sell you the assets and I'll run it for you, right? So he came down and we made a deal, the pool of the Copacabana Palace. And basically, I sold him Data News. And we called the company Computer World of Brazil. And we continued to publish Data News, and then we had real magazines afterwards, et cetera. And then I continued to run the business, and then we started Computer World businesses in all the major countries of Latin America, in Mexico, Venezuela, Argentina.
Amazing.
And I had a great time. It was a great great experience. He was the best mentor.
I mean, he's a legend, right?
Yeah, and he was, it's true. That at the end of the year, he would visit every single office where there was a Computer World employee and personally hand over the year-end bonus.
Wow.
With knowing, we briefed him a little bit, but he would recognize who these people were and say something to them. And it was unbelievable. He would go around the world and do that.
Wow, incredible.
Yeah, so
it was a lot of miles.
Right. So I did all this, and then my daughter was born. She was born in Brazil, and it was at the time where there was the beginning of democracy, and that was great. However, with democracy also came violence, and kidnappings of executives.
Yeah,
and
there's no easy road to freedom, huh?
No, right. So, with a baby on my hands, and I thought, well, I've done pretty much everything that I can do with Computer World. I think I'm going to move to the U.S. So I said to Pat, I'm going to move. And I would love to stay with Computer World or with IDG, but I understand if there's nothing. So he thought about it, and then he IDG or computer, he had the very first microcomputer. So it was before the PCs.
Yep.
The very first microcomputer publication called InfoWorld.
Wow.
So I don't know if you remember InfoWorld.
Of course.
Right.
But I grew up on it.
The first InfoWorld was a tabloid format that was folded in two so that you could display it on the newsstands. It was a consumer book. And then you opened it, and then it was just like a newspaper, like a PC World, PC Week, one of these so forth. So it had fallen on hard. So it was based in Menlo Park, California. And it had fallen on hard times because the InfoWorld folks had made a bet that the personal computer was going to be a personal computer. And then the competitor, Ziff Davis, had launched PC Week and had made the bet that the personal computer was going to be a business machine.
Mm.
And so PC Week was a controlled circulation. You had to qualify. It was free if you could prove that you were an IT manager.
Right. You fill out those forms.
Yeah. So
all right. When we get back from this break, let's get into the whole PC era and then the internet, which is where I think you really started to make your bones. On this very special episode of This Week in Startups. Yes, Citrix go-to meeting. I use it every day. I use it every way. I cannot tell you enough great things about this product. I've used it for years. And when we started the program, they were like, hey, Jason, these people want to advertise. I was like, here, listen, here's a list of the 10 products I use every week. Ask those people if they want to advertise, because then I can read a commercial and it doesn't sound like a commercial. This is not a commercial. This is an absolute endorsement. Many times I have told people, stop using free services.
don't for your meetings, get a really great high-end service like GoToMeeting, because the meetings will start on time no matter what platform people are on. And you people can dial in on the phone or you can use voice over IP. The HD faces is gorgeous, crisp. It's the best HD video conferencing ever. And I buy these like Logitech 1080p cameras and I give them to all my people instead of the regular cameras that come in most computers, and it's like, it's stunning. I mean, it looks like one of those like systems that used to cost $250,000, except Citrix GoToMeeting cost much less. Meeting is believing, and I can tell you this because I use it literally multiple times a day to do all my meetings. Go to GoToMeeting.com and click the try it free button. Yeah, go to GoToMeeting.com, GoToMeeting.com, click the try it free button, and use the promo code TWIST. You know that promo code, T-W-I-S-T, T-W-I-S-T, TWIST, 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 and you'll get a free 30-day trial. It works. It's awesome. You're going to love it. It's a great product. Thanks again to Citrix GoToMeeting. Meeting is believing. Let's get back to this amazing episode. Hey, everybody. We're here at the Recode Conference. Thanks to Walton and Kara Swisher for putting on such a great event that I just love to come to and I've been coming to for years. And they're so nice that they let me, cherry pick a couple of awesome people who are in the audience or on stage and just get a couple of minutes with them and share their stories with you. Today, Eric Hippeau, who is a legend in the publishing business, the internet business, and in investing. And when we last left our hero, you were coming to the U.S. and then working on InfoWorld and PC Week was happening. God, the PC era was born in the early 80s.
So it was the early 80s. Yeah. You know, I picked it up when I was 80.
And what are you like? You're like 30 years old at this point now?
Yeah, I was 85. Yeah, yeah, I was a little bit more. I was like early 30s.
Early
right?
30s. It was, wow, and you're at the top of your game when the PC comes out.
Right, exactly. So the PC comes out. InfoWorld needs to be repositioned.
Right.
And it was actually, it was Michael Miller who was at the conference. You know, Michael?
Michael Miller, who became the editor-in-chief of PC Magazine.
Yeah.
And the columnist in PC Magazine, John Dvorak, Jim Seymour. Who were the other main columnists in PC Magazine?
Malone. What was his first name?
John Malone.
It wasn't John Malone.
No, it was somebody else.
McCrone. John McCrone.
John McCrone. Like, there's all these like great columnists. Yeah. And I would get PC Magazine, InfoWorld, all these different magazines. And I would love to read those columns, John Dvorak's or Jim Seymour. I think Jim Seymour passed a long time ago.
I think so, yeah.
But my God, these were the legends who actually would report on this new fascinating thing called the PC.
Yeah.
Did you know that was going to be huge?
There was definitely, by then, you know, the actual PC, you know, the right. IBM PC had come out. And you could see that it was going to be a real productivity machine, and it was going to be sold on scale, not the scales that we understood later on. But and then we were all very lucky, and we can get into this to hit the direct marketing. You know, when Michael Dell started selling PCs directly out of his dorm in Austin, Texas.
Yeah, crazy innovation to just sell.
Crazy
direct.
Innovation, yeah. So the pace of change is much faster today, but we it was the first time that we, being part of this industry, really faced this kind of like rapid changes and people creating.
It was the first time in a way the world faced a rapid change from technology like this, maybe TV or radio before
but TV and radio never created this vast ecosystem of companies.
Right.
With the computer, with the PC, you have people making, you know, remember a lot of the functionality of the PC was outside the PC, peripherals and cards.
Right. Memory chips, floppy drives, hard drives.
You had to buy this all kind of
and put it together.
Put it together.
Yeah.
And then the software was starting to be developed, the first spreadsheets and the first productivity tools and all of that.
Right.
And it was happening, you know, really at a fast pace. So, you know, we repositioned InfoWorld to be a control circuit book to fight PC Week. We were actually quite successful at it.
And what, hundreds of thousands of people would get these publications at that era?
PC Week, which I remember the best because then I ran Ziff Davis. PC Week was 110, I think, 1,000 circulation right. base. But the CPMs were gigantic. The CPMs
were hundreds
of
dollars.
Yeah, 120, 140. You know, PC Magazine, we were getting 20, 25,
right.
which was already pretty big.
Right.
But 100 plus was enormous because people were paying for the high, you know, selection and the high quality of the audience.
These were IT managers who were making millions of dollar decisions to buy 5,000 PCs or 5,000 HP printers.
That's right.
Or whatever it was.
Right. And then we had the, you know, going fast forwarding to Ziff Davis, we had the labs that tested all of this. So it was, but just to quickly forward. So InfoWorld is repositioned. We're doing well. We're making money. So it's Michael Miller's editor-in-chief. Jonathan Sachs is our publisher. I don't know if you know, remember Jonathan Sachs. He ended up at AOL, and I think he's retired.
I remember him,
I think he's retired now.
I remember from AOL.
And then throughout this period, kind of the folks at Ziff Davis were, you know, calling me, asking if I wanted to go work with them. And then one day, Bill Ziff calls and he says, we would like you to be the publisher of PC Magazine. And PC Magazine, you know, this is now, this is 86.
Yeah, it's a Bible. It's
89, sorry, it's 89. So it's it's like, it's already coming out twice a month.
It's 300 pages.
It's 300 pages. It's mostly, well, it's not mostly ads because you have to have a ratio, but it's a lot of ads.
Yeah.
And it's the pinnacle of the industry. You know, you can't get better than PC Magazine.
No, it would be like being asked, you know, to go work at the New Yorker or Vanity Fair or something, you know, if you were into the literary or whatever scene. And there were hundreds of companies making PCs.
Oh, yeah.
We'll just wait for 1 second for that hang glider to go by here in beautiful Southern California. Wow. And yeah, you had Falcon Computer and Eagle Computer and Dell and everything.
And then Dell created all, you know, there was a lot of Me Toos.
Right.
You know, people like Gateway.
Gateway, sure. That was like the Dell. So you take that gig and then eventually they put you in charge as the Ziff family.
Yeah, so a year later, again, you know, by coincidence, I was there and they wanted a president, so I became the president, and then a few months later I became the CEO.
Yeah.
And then they asked me to sell the business.
Hmm.
And so the business is not just magazines, right? Hmm. The business is also...
Let's wait 1 second while this plane goes by. This is the live recording here in Southern California. Another...
This one's moving
slower. That's like a slow military plane.
It's moving slower.
Aviation is very big here in Southern California.
So it's kind of like, so you've got a big market research company, you've got a big database company, you've got a big magazine company, you've got trade shows.
Wow, yeah.
You've got an educational, so it's...
These companies are making tens of millions of dollars a year.
Yeah, and it's all serving the tech industry.
All serving the tech industry.
Yeah.
Pre-blogs, pre-the web, there was no World Wide Web.
Yeah, we were the first ones, if you remember.
Prodigy?
We had our own services.
Oh, yeah, BBSs.
On CompuServe, which was kind of the first online service.
Yep.
Was really on, it was
CompuServe.
Ziff Davis, ZDNet already, or ZiffNet, what we
ZiffNet,
were called.
Whatever, on CompuServe.
On CompuServe, we had it on AOL.
Yep.
And then we had it on Prodigy. And then at the back of PC Magazine, you had all these little programs that, you know, it sounds so archaic right now. We published all these little kind of programs that you had to retype in your computer.
Yeah, right. No, you write code in BASIC.
In BASIC.
This is, you're talking about my like teenage years was typing that stuff in.
Yeah.
Which when you became CEO eventually, we had a meeting when I was doing the Silicon Report. You remember me coming by your office?
I think so, yeah.
As like a 25-year-old kid. I was in awe. Like, I can't believe I'm at Ziff Davis with Eric Hippeau.
One Park Avenue.
And I was showing you the magazine. You just gave me feedback on the magazine. Yeah. I'll never forget it.
Yeah, and we had, that's what PC Labs was.
Yep.
A quick, really funny aside is we, after we published these things, these basic programs, we actually were the first to offer them as a download. So you could dial up into our computers at 300 baud.
Yeah, I had that Ventel modem.
Yeah, and you could then download this program, which is a huge advance over typing them yourself. And one day, we were doing all this at One Park Avenue, and one day Verizon just shuts us down, shuts down everything, our telephones. Wow. And we said, what's going on? And they said, well, we know that something bizarre is happening on your lines, you know, that it doesn't sound like voice. And we said, no, it's data. And I said, well, we don't know what you're doing, so we're shutting you down.
And we said, well, Verizon didn't even understand the idea that you...
Yes.
And by the way, folks, when you would connect to these modems, some of them you took the handset of your phone, which was standardized, like AT&T and Bell sold one type of phone.
Right.
And you would stick the phone into a coupler.
You had to sync them.
And you'd sync it. So the sound, the data would be transferred over sound into the speaker and receiver.
Right. And then it would, because it was so slow and so much static, it would get interrupted.
Oh, his data was terrible. It would be constantly. Yeah. So eventually become CEO of that, and the internet happens.
Right, the internet happens. So, and then the Ziff family decides that they want to be out of the business. And so I sell the business. At first, I sell it mostly to Forstmann Little, which was a buyout firm, a PE firm. And then SoftBank really wanted to buy it, but they were offering stock, so the family didn't want to take the SoftBank stock. So they instead bought our trade show business as a consolation prize. Prize. And then for a 10-month period, we were owned by this PE firm. In the meantime, Masa-san, you know, the
founder of
SoftBank, who was at the conference today.
Who is incredible at the conference today.
Buys Comdex, which was the biggest trade show in North America. Biggest trade show in tech, but the biggest trade show of all trade shows.
This is before CES.
Yeah, before CES. And so, and then 10 months later, Forstmann Little sells him SoftBank, Ziff Davis, and we put all of that back together. Now we're bigger, we've got Comdex, and then towards the end of the late 90s, we spin out our internet business, ZDNet.
ZDNet got spun out. Right. That was a very popular thing to do, was to take the internet business and put it on its own tracking stock. Yeah, it's crazy, right?
Yeah, it was crazy. But so the
other Dan.
That Rosenzweig, who now is the CEO of Chegg.
Who was at Chegg, yeah.
Right. And so what, another thing that happens is when we were about to sell Ziff Davis to SoftBank, we were about to make a small investment, $5 million investment in Yahoo.
And Yahoo at the time is Jerry Yang and David Filo.
And TK had just joined.
Yeah.
Tim Kugel. And it was a proverbial 12 guys above a Chinese restaurant, which is true, in Mountain View.
Yeah, this is not a metaphor. It was literally Chinese food coming up, wafting to the office. Yeah. And their servers were in that room.
Yes.
And then eventually the servers went to Mark Andreessen's office for Netscape because he had more servers and bandwidth.
Right. And then the service was... it was the beginning. This is literally the birth of the web. So the internet was created kind of a few years before, but there was really no way to navigate the web. So then comes the browser, and then suddenly
Mosaic,
and suddenly you can actually look at the internet and go from one site. That was a really
hyperlink was like blew people's minds.
It blew people's minds. So the business then. So what David and Jerry was here too. I don't know if you saw him.
Yeah, I saw him. He was walking around. Yeah. That was great.
So the both of them decided that it was time to organize the internet. Mm. So they built a platform that was at the time mostly manual, and people would submit to them, say, please consider my site and put it on your search engine, which was really more of a directory.
It was a directory. Here's arts and entertainment. Here's photography, and then here's nude photography.
Right. So these two guys who were engineers out of Stanford. Had no background in bibliography or anything like this. So said, okay, well, this one belongs to rentals, automobiles. So
they're trying to build some crazy taxonomy.
Right. Yeah. And the biggest challenge at the time was that they were getting like 2,000 or 3,000 submissions a day, and it was hard to keep up.
Right.
And then as soon as we make the investment, they're getting 5,000, 10,000.
Crazy. Crazy. And you invested $5 million. Do you remember what the valuation was?
Well, no. So what happened was I sell the business to Masa, immediately introduce him to the team, to Jerry and David, et cetera, because I really wanted to keep that investment. He falls in love with the business as well, says, one thing he said, to Jerry and TK, I really understand why Eric wants to put $5 million in, and I'm completely supportive, but I want to invest $100 million.
Whoa.
And Jerry says, we're very flattered, it's great, but we don't need $100 million. And he said, Jerry, everyone needs $100 million.
You remember that quote? That's a quote that will stick with you.
Yeah.
So Masa at the time was the richest man in Asia, I believe.
Not yet.
He was on his way, though.
The reason why I knew Masa well is because he was our licensee. In Japan, so he published PC Magazine, PC Week.
He was a publisher, like
his first business was he was the first micro or PC computer distributor. See, he was the distributor for all of Microsoft products. In Japan, so he really understood how PCs were going to change.
And he understood the internet implicitly just by seeing it. Boom. Yes. He just knew this could be huge.
Yes. Yeah.
And so he puts $100 million into...
And the deal was that we've now being SoftBank, we're going to own a third of Yahoo at the IPO price.
Wow.
And so that turned out to be $102 million, whatever it was.
Right.
Or 100 and whatever. And then also he negotiated to launch Yahoo Japan.
Right.
Which only cost $2 million and became... as valuable as Yahoo US.
Yeah.
So it became instantly profitable.
And the US owned like a third of it or something. They owned some...
More, 40%. It was 60-40, and that became the model. That became the model for a whole bunch of other joint ventures that have always been very successful in Japan.
All right, when we get back from this break, let's talk a little bit more about investing and then the birth of the web on this very special episode of The Swing Startups. Thanks to our friends at Citrix ShareFile. Yes, Citrix ShareFile is designed for business, and you can use it, and you can trust it, and you can send files securely. Yes, that's right. Intellectual property, contracts, term sheets, all the important things that you do not want to attach to an email, you can send as a secure link with ShareFile. And of course, you can access these from any computer or any mobile device, and you can send files of almost any size. Here's how we use it here. We just use it to request a file. We click, and it goes to a specified folder. We get email alerts when people have uploaded stuff. So if it's a term sheet or something, I'm angel investing. And you can go see those downloads. You control who has access to it in a very granular way with a very detailed level of permission, which is very cool. And we also share all these large video clips that we do here with the show and the conferences. So if you want to try it, go ahead and go to sharefile.com, and I highly recommend you do, and click the podcast microphone button and use the offer code TWIST. There's no credit card required, and it's a 30-day free trial. Just click on the podcast microphone button and use the offer code TWIST. 30-day free trial, no credit card required. And here's an exclusive ShareFile video for you. Yes, the top 10 questions asked and answered by the world's greatest investors, including Dave Cohen, Joanne Wilson, Dave McClure, Steve Jervison, Brad Fell, Mark Suster, and more. Step one, sign up for ShareFile. Use the promo code TWIST. And then number two, request a file by sending it to sharefile@launch.co. That's it. Super simple. It's an all-new video, and it's only available through ShareFile. Thanks again to our friends at Citrix ShareFile. We love you guys for just making a great product and for supporting the program. Let's get back to this amazing episode. Hey, everybody. It's Jason. We're here at the Recode Code Conference in Southern California. My guest, Eric Hippeau, is with us. And God, the birth of the internet. Masa puts in 100 million or 102 million to own a third of Yahoo. And then he owns 60% of Yahoo Japan, which I guess to this day, Yahoo still owns a large portion of.
Yahoo is probably still owns like 33 or 35%.
Right.
And it's part of the famous Asian assets that that prop up the stock at Yahoo,
right,
in addition to Alibaba, which, by the way, is also was a deal that Masa brought Yahoo into.
Mm.
So
so you're responsible for getting Masa into Yahoo, and Masa's responsible for getting Yahoo into Alibaba.
Yes.
So in a way, Marissa getting all of this huge windfall of billions of dollars traces this all the way back to you, Eric.
Well, maybe, yeah, if you want to look at it this way.
It does.
Way.
I mean, it would not have happened. Jerry would not have invested all of that. I mean, it's amazing, like, how things happen in the world and who gets credit for them, right?
Yeah, sure.
I mean, you were this, like, hardworking guy who, like, really just made all this glue come together.
Right. Well, and, look, it was fun. There was all kinds of things. You know, and we, as Ziff Davis, we were in the middle of all this, so we had a tremendous amount of deal flow. You know, U.S. Web, GeoCities.
Or, mm-hmm.
And so SoftBank eventually decides to organize funds.
Right.
To take advantage to become investors. And
right.
That's how the SoftBank Technology Ventures funds became came about. And then they became Mobius. Mm. And to another person who is here today is Gary Richel.
Right.
Who was kind of the managing partner
of Mobius.
Of Mobius and previously at SoftBank Technology
and
Ventures.
And Brad Fell was involved.
Yeah, Brad Fell.
And the Flatiron Partners, Fred and Jerry, had some SoftBank money in their fund.
We did that. We also did GeoCities together with
right,
them.
Right, which was Fred's biggest hit up to that point.
Yeah, exactly. And I was also on the board of GeoCities because he had come through us.
Huh.
And then we merged that with Yahoo, as you know.
I was there the day David Bonnet came to meet with them, and the original company was Beverly Hills Internet.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't even called GeoCities. It was just storefronts on the web.
Yeah, and you can argue that that was the very first social network.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
The only reason why it wasn't is because there was really no communications layer possible.
No, there was no graph. The graph was there, but there was no layer.
Yeah.
You know, you could bookmark each other.
But the same functionality of publishing, having your own page, publishing your own information.
Yeah, updating it. Yeah.
Yeah, updating it existed.
So you do a bunch of years investing.
Right. So then eventually we sell. Masa, as he explained today at the conference, sees an opportunity to build a nationwide fast and cheap broadband network in Japan. So in order to do that, he needs quite a few dollars or yens. So he instructs us to sell a lot of the assets that SoftBank had in the United States, and that included Ziff Davis.
And this is 99?
This is 99, yeah.
So his timing is perfect.
Yes.
Yeah. Things are peaking.
Things are absolutely, and particularly in the magazine business.
Oh, yeah.
And you were there.
I was there. No, I went from 75, 80 employees and $12 million that I built off my back to nothing.
Well, you could see the writing was on the wall because, you know, a big part of our business, you know, you remember Computer Shopper?
Sure.
So Computer Shopper was all direct sales.
Yeah.
Direct marketing vendors. You know, we published the maximum number of pages that the biggest printer in the United States, or Canada in this case, could handle, which was 1,100 pages.
It's crazy.
So we maxed that out.
Yeah.
And 75% of that was advertising, which was the limit that the post office allowed us.
Right.
And so we wrote that, and you could see the profits of that would be enormous, right?
Yeah.
So, but you could see that was already shifting to the internet because of the search engines facilitated that, et cetera.
Yeah.
So the writing was on the wall. And so we sold everything. He built this big network and eventually bought the mobile phone business from Vodafone, which became SoftBank Mobile.
Right.
And it was in those years that he became, you know, kind of the second richest man in Japan and a very, very powerful person.
Yeah.
And then we regrouped, Ron Fisher, myself, we regrouped around kind of SoftBank Capital.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I ended up investing in the Huffington Post.
Ah.
And meeting.
In 2004, 2005 time frame.
It was 2007.
Yeah, I remember this because Arianna Huffington had talked to me and said, "Oh, Jason, I want to talk to you about," this is my Arianna Huffington impersonation, "I want to talk to you about the blogs, because you have the blogging company, Weblogs Inc.,
right,
and the Engadget, and I want to understand how the blogging works." And so I went to visit with her, and she had this idea for Huffington Post, or you guys all did.
Yeah.
And that just grew tremendously off of a crazy concept, which was you were going to not pay the authors.
Right. And
it was going to be contributors who were celebrities or whatever. As a publisher for decades, when you heard this crazy idea, what did you think?
I thought it was brilliant. I thought here's a company that has built an incredible technology platform. So technology came first.
Yeah.
And as you know, we later on...
But wasn't it like a CMS from somebody else? Wasn't it like somebody else's Drupal or something? Did they build that whole CMS?
Yeah, but it was
adapted.
We gutted it.
It
was the very first 6 months, I guess, with that, and then we just completely rebuilt it.
Huh?
Because we had to be responsive to Google, particularly with the SEO.
Yeah, stuff. You guys crushed it on SEO.
Yeah, exactly. So and then we also were able to build all these productivity tools so that one editor could literally control, you know, half a dozen stories live or more. So the productivity of the team was enormous, and you could react, the editors could react in real time to changes in the stories. So the stories were continuously changing and evolving without having deadlines, without saying, well, I need to change that story at 5 p.m. That was also a big novelty.
Yeah. Do you think as an executive you were able to free yourself of the bias of things that you had spent 30 years reinforcing, like paying authors, like, you know, the time of publishing? Was it just something you were just always open to change, or did you have to fight against some instinct as a publisher?
No, I mean, you know, at Ziff Davis, we were, our ZDNet business, which we spun off, was worth hundreds of millions of dollars. So we espoused this online business, and I always thought of it as being complementary to the print business. You know, I think the mistake is to think that one replaces the other. So in the case of the Huffington Post, you know, this idea that you don't pay the authors. Okay, so we were putting a service at their disposal. So all of the authors, none of them were obligated to write.
Right.
Right?
No, they weren't. They didn't have a gun to their head.
No, but what they had, it was an instantaneous large-scale audience that was very responsive. As you know, the comments were incredible. I mean, we would generate, I think when we sold the business to AOL, we were generating 6-7 million comments a month. And so if you're Hillary Clinton, right, and you want a platform to talk about whatever ideas you have, and to have a curated comment platform. There's a lot of technology so that you're not getting attacked personally.
Right.
There's no trolls or anything like that. And if I paid you $400, if you're Hillary Clinton...
Yeah, no. Right? She's not doing it for that reason.
No,
they got George Clooney and Hillary Clinton. Exactly. They're not doing it for any other reason than they want to have their words read.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So we were providing a tremendous service to these people and a, you know, an environment of safety and where... good discussions could be had.
And that business you wind up selling to AOL.
Yeah.
And they've done a pretty good job with it, you think?
I think they've done a great job. If I look at ComScore, they're right on top. You know, they're number two to whoever, and they're doing extremely well.
Did you guys
sell? But we also did BuzzFeed afterwards.
Right. Did you sell Huffington Post too early, you think?
Well, as you might know, I mean, I'm the board member. I was also the CEO at the time.
Yeah.
So I'm the board member on record with Fred Harmon at Oak to say that we thought it was worth more.
Yeah.
But
you thought it'd become a billion-dollar business.
Yeah. Yeah, and it would have, definitely, for sure.
So then you did sell it a little bit too early.
We sold it too early, but it was a good deal for everybody. Everybody was happy. You know, so it's one of these. It was a great return for our fund. Ariana wanted a bigger platform. Mm-hmm. So it all worked out great.
Yeah, you have to build consensus as an investor. You don't control everything. Right. You have a bunch of constituents, so you don't always get to pick, do you?
No, exactly. And look, we did our job as investors. It was a really great VC return.
Now you're doing Lear Hippeau Ventures.
Right. So with Kenny Lehrer, who's my partner, and his son Ben.
Now, what's Kenny Lear's deal? Who is this person that we all hear about who invests in content businesses? What's his background? We all know your background.
Yeah, Kenny's extremely well known in New York in communications, strategic PR. Mm. He had his own firm.
Yeah.
He was partnered with James Robinson's wife.
Yeah.
It was Larry Robinson or whatever the name was.
James Robinson of Coca-Cola fame.
Yeah, exactly. And
now RRE Ventures too.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. And so he was kind of the go-to person. If you had a strategic, he was an advisor to Bill Gates, and he's an incredibly discerning communications person. He has a great nose for product. Mm. He's very succinct. He's very straight. You know, he's straightforward.
Yeah.
Etc. So he was. Eventually, he sells that business and joins AOL Time Warner at the time of the merger.
Yeah.
Because he had been at MTV with Bob Pittman before, so he knew that whole crowd. That he does that for 2 or 3 years, leaves, and thinks of retiring, and starts, of all things, an anti-NRA website.
An anti-NRA website.
Yes, which, you know, takes a little bit of courage to do, right?
Yeah. kind of puts a target on your back.
Right. So he did this for a while, and he sells it to the... is it the Brady Organization? You know, the anti-gun. You remember?
Yeah, sure, sure. Brady, who was shot along with Reagan.
Yeah, so he sells that, or he gives it to them.
Right.
Whatever.
He gifts it.
And meets Ariana, and they start.
They fall in love.
Yeah. They start the
Not literally, course. But on a professional basis, exactly. Business basis. What is the thesis? Because most people don't like to invest in content, and you guys have taken it to another level with Huffington Post. That was an extraordinary exit. People have never seen a publication, if you qualify it as a publication, get sold for $300 million. It just doesn't happen. Like, even in the heyday, the Spins and Rolling Stones, I mean, maybe they started to hit hundreds of millions of dollars or $100 million valuation, but it's very rare that a publication hits that. Why are you guys not afraid of content? Why is it a good business?
Because it's technology first and content second, or you can say it's technology with content.
Got it.
And this is, by the way, the argument at Yahoo that I never really understood is, are we a tech company or are we a content company? Well, why can't you be both?
Right.
You know, in fact, today...
Why are they scared of that? Because of the market valuations or something?
It's the culture in the valley. It's a misunderstanding of what media is. It's a bunch of things. But
right.
But with the Huffington Post and now, you know, other companies like that are part of our ecosystem, like BuzzFeed and Posse Mike and others, Circa, which I think you...
Circa, yeah. I'm a small investor in, yeah.
Yeah, right. If you look at the way these companies start, they start by building a platform first. They have a point of view. Take Now This News, which is a company that we founded recently. Now This News, the point of view is Instagram, Vine, Snapchat, WeChat, etc. are these new platforms that scale with incredible numbers. You know, 0 to 500 million active users in a year.
Yeah.
Right. That require content, except that the content in this particular case of Now This News is videos that have 6, 10, 15 second, 20 second lifespan.
Right.
And so you have to learn how to break stories and tell, you know, news within this format.
Right.
So what do you do? So the first thing you do is you build a technology platform that does that, that knows how to deliver that particular, on scale, deliver that content, gives the editors a chance to edited in that format. Mm-hmm. So all of these companies start with a platform that has a goal, point of view, right?
A point of view and a goal, yeah.
And a goal, right? Yeah. And then you then add the content.
And then iterate on it.
So that's why we've always felt, and now is the golden age of content.
It is. Why is it the golden age of content now, you think?
Because content, everyone is consuming media 24/7.
Ah, so the ability to consume has gone way up. We're consuming more.
Way more.
Now, the criticism of content today is, hey, and it's been leveled both at Huffington Post when they did like sort of the unbylined articles, the short little stub articles, SEO kind of stuff, and then later at BuzzFeed for the social media optimization, like, hey, here's a billion, you know, like cat pictures or whatever. What do you think about the sort of criticism of those platforms of like, hey, it's schlocky at time or it's lower quality?
So
how do you respond to that kind of criticism?
You know, well, first of all, who is the arbiter of that? You know, who's deciding what's good quality? You know,
you would not publish cat pictures in a Ziff Davis publication or whatever. Right?
No, but probably my audience wouldn't appreciate them. But what we do know is that when you put a good series of cat pictures on BuzzFeed, people love them.
Right.
So that tells you that that's something that people want to consume. They want to share that. They want to, you know, comment on it.
Right.
But that's not all you do. So you do some of that, and then you do your own reporting. So BuzzFeed today has, I'm going to pick a number, over 200 journalists.
Like real journalists, like New York Times.
Breaking stories.
Washington Post. Like it's legitimate journalists in between which Game of Thrones character you are. Because even during the conference, like, Gwyneth Paltrow, or maybe the person who was doing the poetry today here at the Recode conference, was sort of making fun of the BuzzFeed, like, what Game of Thrones character you are. That's sort of like pop culture stuff.
Yeah.
But you're putting next to a pop culture thing like that, that sometimes people will criticize, like an actual real journalist covering real stuff.
We have a field reporter in the Ukraine on the line of fire. We have a whole investigative journalism team that does long form journalism.
Whose idea was this to mix the kitten GIFs and GIFs and the Ukraine stuff in one? This to me seems either the work of an insane person or a genius.
Well,
Whose idea was that?
I don't know. You know Jonah. Do you know Jonah Peretti?
I know Jonah Peretti.
So he is a genius.
But he's also a little bit of a madman? Or where does this come from? Because you would not, I would not as a publisher think of this idea. Would you?
Jonah has spent his entire career thinking about and analyzing and looking at data of why content gets viral and why it gets shared.
Got it.
So he's a very pragmatic guy. He's looking at data. He says, people love this stuff. I'm going to give them more of that. But on the other hand, I'm also going to introduce them to hard news. I'm going to introduce them to investigative journalism. And maybe the consumption of that won't be at the same level as my cats. But because of the scale, right? We're talking, you know, BuzzFeed is well over 150 million uniques. So,
150 million uniques.
Yeah. So just because of the scale,
it
doesn't take much of a fraction of that audience to be interested in the Ukraine news, to actually have more coverage, more people reading the news about the Ukraine on your platform than anybody else's platform.
And what is it like for you as the investor when you see the New York Times writing this big report on their demise and their confounded, you know, nature, and the examples are Business Insider, BuzzFeed, and Huffington Post are the people who are rattling their cage, your investments. What's that like for you as an investor to see that?
Well, you know, I love the New York Times. I'm a New Yorker.
Sure.
This is the only newspaper I still subscribe to.
Right.
I think it's tremendous journalism. And we have to remember that they were pioneers online. New York Times Digital, with Martin Nisenholtz, came out in 96 or whatever it came out.
Yeah, and they bought About.com at some point.
Yeah,
I mean,
exactly.
They've done a ton.
So they this might be just a wake-up call for them to say, hey, guys, we were pioneers. We kind of like lost our way a little bit, but the DNA is there. We can also do some of this.
If you were running it, would you say, hey, let's follow the Business Insider link baiting slideshows and the Game of Thrones, what character you are from BuzzFeed, or should they stay true to their nature? If they put you in charge, you're the CEO now and Arthur retires, what would you do, Eric?
No, I think you've got to be true to the brand.
But you can't grow then.
But yes, you can.
Okay,
yes,
how?
You can.
How?
Well, you can have quality journalism on all the platforms that we talked about.
Mm. So they're just not wide enough on all these different platforms.
But you can't repurpose the same content.
Ah.
You have to create new content. You have to be original on those platforms.
Right.
You have to be native.
Right.
I think maybe that's the big lesson for anybody who in the content world. Repurposing doesn't work.
Mm.
You've got to be native. So you've got to rethink. The news is the news, right?
Right.
What's happening in the Ukraine is happening in the Ukraine. Just the way you tell the story is going to be very, very different.
They've embraced blogs. That gets them somewhere. Yeah. And you've seen their sort of snow crash or what are some of the other things they've
there's
done.
There's the multimedia.
The multimedia stuff. Snowfall,
Yes, yeah.
What do you think of those efforts?
I think all of these are valid and good experiments. I just wish that they would put more consistency behind them. Okay,
yeah.
Let's not just have one.
Right.
Why don't we have one a day?
You have seen now that the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal is not the destination for the top talent in the world. Walt Mossberg left the Wall Street Journal to come here and do Recode. Arguably, that's like the best gig for Walt Mossberg or any tech journalist could ever have, is being the voice of the Wall Street Journal. Then you have David Pogue, who I don't actually think is a great journalist, but I'll put that aside. But, you know, who is a big voice at the New York Times, leaves to go to Yahoo News. And you have many different journalists leaving the New York Times to go to BuzzFeed or other places.
Katie Couric went to Yahoo.
Yeah, exactly. So what does it say for those publications that now the top talent doesn't want to work there anymore?
They have to. This is a really big wake-up call. See, the most people in traditional media convince themselves, and I was guilty of the same thing, and maybe you were too, when something plateaus, a show, a magazine, a product plateaus, first of all, these are most traditional media products are super high margin. You know, you're talking 40% EBITDA margin, whatever, right? So you convince yourself that you can manage that decline.
Right.
So now you're looking at the cash flow. You say, okay, I'll be down 5% next year. And then
I cut costs 5%. Yeah.
But it doesn't work that way. Hmm. It might work that way as you go over that hump, but suddenly you fall off a cliff.
Right.
And if you look at newspapers, the history of newspapers, if you track newspapers over a 30-year period, when the audience started to decline maybe about 20 years ago. So the audience declines. Advertising continues to rise.
Right.
Because advertising is a laggard business. Mm. It's not a forward-thinking business, right? So it continues to rise, then it tapers off, and then it just falls off a cliff.
Right.
And it's because the advertisers at some point realize that they're in a dying ship.
They're in the wrong place.
Yeah. And once they leave, they don't ever come back.
Wow. Yeah.
Right.
So magazines, newspapers, demolished.
Yeah. TV is going to have the same thing is going to happen to television.
It is.
Yes. TV, the model that we know today, which is I have to be in front of the tube.
Yeah.
You're
going
to serve me these 30, 60 second spots that I charge a fortune for.
Yeah.
And the fact is that as we know it, nobody watches TV like this anymore.
Hmm.
Except people in their 60s or older.
Right.
But the young generation whom the advertisers want.
Yeah, they're on their mobile phones or tablets.
They're watching on
time
demand,
shifting, you know, whatever.
They never see the ads.
Yeah.
They never see the ads. So why are the advertisers still there?
It doesn't make much sense.
It makes no sense whatsoever. And no, we're not talking small amounts of money. We're talking about 70, depends on whose number you trust, $70 to $100 billion in the United States alone is spent to address an audience that's gone away.
And that's all going to dump over, you think, to the web,
yes,
and to internet native stuff.
Yeah. The native stuff is the trigger.
What do you think of all this native advertising? Because that's another thing when you look at the innovations of BuzzFeed, Gawker, but also the criticism is, hey, you're using the same editorial group to write, you know, an article for a sponsor. And some people argue, hey, on BuzzFeed, it's not always completely clear. It's not the same people.
No, not the same people. So,
they have like the little editors over here.
So there's the usual kind of Chinese wall,
yep,
between edit and the commercial side.
Yep.
It's a completely separate group. I think at BuzzFeed we have about 50 people now. It's like an agency inside BuzzFeed.
So it's more of like an agency feel.
Yeah,
those are more
exactly.
copywriters.
Now, you know, they pay attention to the news and what's going on. At Nowadays News, we have one sponsor who is embedded into not the newsroom, but embedded at the office because they want to follow the news and create videos in real time to react to the news. So that's crazy
innovative.
Yeah, that's a very, very big deal.
Can you imagine that? It would be like, oh, why is it a big deal? Yeah.
Well, no, because marketing is not only is marketing moving to social, which is big difference, right? But it's moving to real time. Mm. And it puts the entire model on its head, because if you look at the agencies and you look at the budgets, everything is still very much campaign driven.
Right.
Right? I have a product, I know I'm gonna launch it in October. I'm gonna advertise it from October to plan for it in the spring.
Right.
I'm gonna launch in October, I'm gonna finish the advertising in December, I'm gonna measure it for 3 months, and I'm gonna do this all over again.
Right, we'll take what we learned. Yeah. It's a cycle.
So I don't know what period of time, so a few months a year, I'm completely dark. People don't think I exist anymore.
Right.
So imagine if you're Coca-Cola and you did this to your Facebook page.
Right.
Right?
People are like, what's going on?
Yeah.
It makes no sense.
I'm sorry, I can't update my Facebook page because my CFO tells me I have no budget.
Yeah.
Right, so the whole world of marketing has moved to real-time kind of publishing updates all the time, but the way that they still build the budgets for marketing are exactly the contrary to that. So there's a big shift to come.
You have two or three funds or something, and how big are your funds? How big are your investments typically?
Well, we're the most active early-stage investor in New York. So, the two things distinguish us. One is we do 70% of our investments in New York, so we don't travel for business. Mm. We are always seed first investors, and then we keep money in reserve to do follow-ons, and that model has really worked well for us.
You don't want to come in later rounds. You want to pro rata, whatever.
No, yeah, we use our pro rata.
Yeah.
So our funds are relatively small, but we raise more often. So the fund that we just finished investing is $36 million. We're just in raising at the moment, which of course we're not allowed to talk about.
Right, we won't talk about that.
But every 16 months or so, we raise another fund.
Yeah. And where do you see the content space, we'll end on this, in another 5-10 years? What's it all going to look like? Because you already have BuzzFeed having, a magnitude bigger audience than the New York Times. You have Gawker breaking stories that typically would have been broken by the Post or, Vanity Fair or Variety. It just seems like the whole world's changing. What do you think it looks like 5-10 years from now?
Well, obviously that's a long time, and it's very hard. It's very hard to imagine. I think that a lot of, because mobile lends itself well to video, because it's easier to watch a video than to read something on mobile, right?
Sure.
So I think we're going to see tremendous growth in original video content. BuzzFeed's building a big, we already have a studio in LA, we're building a bigger one. So you're going to see a lot of video. You're going to see TV as we know it won't exist. So TV will mostly be for live events, because that's still the only way that you can gather large audiences, and also the money. Although I'm thinking that if you're looking at 5-10 years from now, people that we can't even imagine will be bidding for the NFL rights and sports rights.
Google,
perhaps.
Yeah. That's
the
rumor going around. Google's
today they don't feel that they can gather that large audience all at once yet.
Yeah.
But Yes, but 5-10 years from now.
You think the Googles of the world are going to start buying up the cable channels, or going into original programming? Because you see Yahoo starting to dip their toe. You talked before about, hey, they were afraid to call them a content company, but now you have Katie Couric and David Poe getting picked up by Marissa.
There's no reason to buy the current cable channels, because you can't repurpose that content on digital.
What about the TV shows? I mean, you do have tremendous success with Netflix and
I think the TV
doing
shows,
original programming.
Yeah,
so you see Google eventually maybe having a studio and giving $1 billion to create original programming. They did it with YouTube a little bit. It's a little small test.
YouTube should do it for sure.
Yeah.
And that's Google, right? So they definitely should do it. I think Amazon's doing it, Yahoo's doing it, Netflix is doing it.
Yeah.
And that's just the beginning.
Yeah.
So and shows will look very different, very likely. Mm-hmm. The whole half-hour format, of which 10 minutes is ads.
Yeah, 8 minutes of ads, 21 minutes, whatever.
So that's probably why should it be that way, right? Yeah. It doesn't have to be that way.
Go as long as you want. Listen, Eric, this has been amazing. You've been a great inspiration to me in my career, and it's just so great to sit here and just go through the whole like history of it and continued success with everything. It's amazing what you guys have done just in content. And as a content person, I'm in awe of like the stuff you've done later. Even later in your career, I think you're doing your most innovative stuff. Which I mean,
I'm having fun. Yeah.
I mean, you did so much innovative stuff in the early years, but now it just feels like you're in such a good groove and with Lear and Hippeau Ventures that you're just crushing it. So continued success. And then if people want to pitch you on their content business, they can find you online or whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
What do you look for? Is it something that you see in somebody like, let's say Matt from Circa or whoever it is that you say like, oh, that's it. I got to write a check.
Yeah, well, that was an obvious. So Circa, right? I mean, you know, if you're going to have breaking news on your mobile device, the whole structure of how you put the content together has to be very different. As you know, he does it in blocks.
Yep.
So that he
chunks.
Can so then he can realize these chunks,
change them, switch them around.
Yeah, exactly. So it's very innovative. Policy Mike. Mm. I don't know if you know those guys.
I've heard of it, but I'm not aware of what they do.
Well, they're a bunch of 25-year-olds who believe that other 25-year-olds actually care about serious news.
Mm.
So they've created Policy Mike to cover politics and cover world events. They don't have the cats, you know, they I think they're doing 20 million uniques at the moment.
Wow!
You know,
without cats. If they had cats, they'd be at 200.
Exactly.
And more kittens. There's the lesson, folks. And if we could, Jacob, just you know, cut in some kittens here at the end. Listen, Eric, this has been great for me.
And, my pleasure.
Really appreciate having you. We'll see you next time. And thanks again, Kara and Walt, for hosting us. We'll see you next time on This Week in Startups.